Ya, boleh.
Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Salam, selamat siang, salam sejahtera untuk kita semua. Salam, Om Swastiastu, Namo Buddhaya, salam kebajikan. Yang terhormat Profesor Truman Simanjuntak selaku Ketua Center for Prehistory and Austronesian Studies. Yang terhormat Profesor Anne-Marie Sema, peneliti dari MNHN Perancis selaku narasumber. Serta yang terhormat Bapak Ibu peserta online public talk show CPIS episode kedua pada siang hari ini yang berbahagia. Alhamdulillah, puji syukur kita panjatkan karena berkat rahmatnya kita masih bisa berkumpul untuk bersama-sama menimba ilmu dari narasumber yang luar biasa yang akan kita ikuti melalui Zoom meeting dan channel YouTube CPIS Indonesia. Semoga kita tetap sehat selalu. Online public talk show CPIS kedua kali ini mengusung tema The Dynamic of Paleoclimate in Indonesia. Sebelum memulai acara, perkenankan saya Adi Agus Oktaviana selaku MC pada siang hari ini untuk membacakan susunan acara. Yang pertama, sambutan dari Ketua CPIS, Profesor Truman Simanjuntak. Yang kedua, pemaparan materi oleh Profesor Anne-Marie Sema dengan dimoderatori oleh Muhammad Ruli Fauzi, sekaligus diskusi dan tanya-jawab. Yang terakhir, penutup. Selanjutnya, kita beranjak ke sambutan. Sambutan akan disampaikan oleh Bapak Profesor Dr. Truman Simanjuntak. Kami persilahkan.
Ya, baik. Terima kasih, Mas Adi. Apakah suara saya cukup jelas?
Jelas, Prof.
Terima kasih, jelas. Ya. Oke, jadi selamat sore untuk semuanya yang hadir di dalam forum ini. Ya, salam persaudaraan buat kita. Maaf, ini direkam ya?
Direkam dan disiarkan secara langsung di
okay.
Channel CBS.
Ya, jadi salam persaudaraan buat kita semua. Ya, selamat datang pada diskusi OPT ya, online public talk show ya, yang diorganisasikan oleh CPAS, the Center for Prehistory and Austronesian Studies. Jadi saya juga menyampaikan terima kasih atas kehadiran seluruh yang ada di online ini, dan tentu saya juga ingin menyampaikan terima kasih kepada Ibu Anne-Marie Sema ya, yang telah bersedia meluangkan waktu untuk memenuhi undangan kami sebagai narasumber utama ya, narasumber tunggal di dalam talk show ini ya. Dan saya pikir semua kita atau mungkin hampir semua kita sudah mengenal siapa Ibu Anne-Marie ya. Beliau adalah seorang ahli paleontologi ya, yang bekerja di IRD, Institute de Recherche pour Développement. Jadi Institute of Research for Development ya. Jadi Bu Anne-Marie ini seorang direktur riset di sana ya, dan saya mengenal beliau sudah barangkali lebih dari 40 tahun ya. Ya, lebih dari 40 tahun dan terus kontak kita, interaksi kita berjalan sampai sekarang. Jadi saya mengenal betul Bu Anne-Marie. Ya, juga barangkali perlu saya sampaikan Bu Anne-Marie ini suaminya teman dekat sekali yaitu Pak François Sema ya. Dan saya masih ingat waktu studi di Prancis itu Bu Anne-Marie ini sangat banyak membantu saya. Terutama mengoreksi redaksional disertasi saya. Ya, karena pada waktu itu disertasi harus ditulis dalam bahasa Prancis, Ya. Jadi maklumlah bahasa yang pletot-pletot ya, untung ada Buan Mari bisa memberikan koreksi penting ya hingga disertasi bisa lebih berbunyi gitu. Ya. Jadi itu salah satu pengalaman pribadi saya dengan Buan Mari. Dan kali ini kita so happy gitu ya, so happy ya mendatangkan beliau sebagai pembicara utama tentang judulnya The Dynamic of Paleoclimate in Indonesia. Ya. Barangkali juga perlu saya informasikan bahwa The Center for Prehistorian Austronesian Studies punya apa program bulanan ya, program bulanan mengadakan OPT ya, online public talk show, yaitu untuk mendiskusikan isu-isu yang menarik dan aktual di bidang arkeologi dan disiplin terkait arkeologi, dan juga isu-isu tentang kebangsaan dan keindonesiaan. Ya, jadi ini isu-isu ini yang kita utamakan, bisa kita diskusikan secara rileks begitu untuk menambah pemahaman kita, ya, untuk mengupdate pengetahuan kita. Ya. Dan kita memilih modelnya talk show, ya. Talk show dalam arti tidak kaku sekali seperti seminar, hanya dua arah, ya, dari narasumber ke peserta dan kemudian peserta ke narasumber. Tapi ini talk show, nanti misalkan ada isu-isu yang penting ada dalam pikiran peserta, boleh saja langsung angkat bicara gitu untuk kita diskusikan bersama. Yes. Kita ingin diskusi ini ada komunikasi silang di antara peserta itu. Jadi ini yang saya maksud ya, diskusi yang apa, yang lively dan relaxed gitu, yang hidup gitu. Jadi dengan demikian ya kita berharap sekali diskusi ini dapat memberikan apa, pencerahan ya, to enlighten ya, our understanding in the field of palynology dalam konteks ini gitu. Ya mudah-mudahan lah. Jadi dengan apa, menghadirkan seorang pakar atau super pakar ya sebagai pemacu diskusi kita, maka akan semakin terbuka ya bagi pemikiran kita untuk mengelaborasi ya isu-isu yang menarik atau isu-isu tertentu yang aktual, hingga tentu akan menambah pemahaman kita ya dari berbagai hal. Jadi itu harapan saya, harapan Center for Prehistory and Austronesian Studies. Jadi untuk tidak berpanjang lebar, barangkali saya sekali lagi ingin menyampaikan banyak-banyak terima kasih atas kehadiran para peserta di dalam forum ini. Dan untuk itu terakhir saya ingin menyampaikan selamat berdiskusi. Diskusi kita buka mulai titik ini. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih Prof. Truman atas sambutannya. Selanjutnya kita memasuki acara inti yaitu talk show dengan narasumber Profesor Dr. Anne Marie Sema yang akan dimoderatori oleh Mas Ruli Fauji. Kepada Mas Ruli Fauji kami persilahkan.
Baik, terima kasih Mas A. Terima kasih Profesor Truman atas pembukaannya tadi. Selamat siang. Salam sejahtera bagi kita semua. Assalamualaikum, Om Swastiastu, Namo Buddhaya, salam kebajikan. Oke, jadi seperti yang dikatakan oleh Prof. Truman tadi, CPAS setiap bulannya akan mengadakan satu public online public talk show atau talk show terbuka bagi bagi publik untuk mendiseminasikan atau menyebarluaskan pengetahuan kepada khalayak. Pada kesempatan siang hari ini kita kedatangan menghadirkan seorang pakar, Ibu Anmari Sema. Selamat pagi, bonjour, Ibu Anmari Sema.
Bonjour, selamat siang semuanya.
Oke, jadi seperti yang dikatakan oleh Prof. Truman tadi bahwa ini adalah diskusi publik yang sifatnya terbuka. Kita sudah mendapatkan beberapa viewer di YouTube, terus juga ada beberapa mahasiswa saya lihat di sini, dan kebanyakan juga ada banyak peneliti dari lingkungan Badan Riset dan Inovasi Nasional di Indonesia. Sebelum kita memulai acara, mungkin sebaiknya saya perkenalkan terlebih dahulu Ibu Anmari Sema. Anmari Sema adalah peneliti dari Museum Nasional di Histoire Naturelle sekarang ya Bu ya, dulu di IRD ya Bu ya. Jadi beliau sudah lama sekali malang melintang di dunia riset tentang lingkungan purba, tentang paleoclimate, dengan berbagai proksinya yang nantinya jelasnya akan dijelaskan oleh Ibu Anmari Sema. Dan saya mengundang kepada para hadirin sekalian, jika ada pertanyaan dapat ditaruh di kolom komentar, terus juga dapat bertanya langsung, berdiskusi langsung kepada Ibu Anmari Sema. Pada kesempatan siang hari ini, topik diskusi ini mungkin karena audiens kita kebanyakan orang Indonesia ini, Ibu Anmari Sema, jadi mungkin, tapi terserah kepada Ibu Anmari Sema jika ingin membawakannya dengan bahasa Inggris, it's okay if you want to speak English for the presentation, and then if you want to speak in Indonesia, we also welcome. It's very very welcome for you to speak in Indonesia.
But not French. Huh?
But unfortunately, yeah, because not all people here speaking French or understand French. Maybe some of them understand French. And tidak berpanjang lebar lagi untuk Ibu Anmari Sema, kami persilahkan untuk sharing tentang paleoclimate, the dynamics of paleoclimate in Indonesia.
Maybe I have to share my screen. Yes.
Okay, we see it.
You see me? Yes. Jadi selamat siang semuanya dan terima kasih untuk undangan, Pak Truman, Ruli, AA. Dan semua teman saya. Kebetulan saya tidak berani berbahasa Indonesia karena saya sedikit lupa dan bahasa saya kurang halus. Tapi bahasa Inggris tidak begitu bagus juga. Tapi saya kurang tahu, mungkin saya campur dua-duanya. Nanti kita lihat. Jadi, I would like to talk about the dynamics of paleo environments and paleoclimates in Indonesia from the point of view of the vegetation and with paleontological proxy for the Quaternary period, of course. I will insist about Java because I work there, but many studies have been and are undertaken until now on many islands of Indonesia, like Sumatra, Papua, Kalimantan, Sulawesi, etc. In fact, to reconstruct the changing of environment and climate, many proxies are used. Seperti bisa dilihat di sini, ada beberapa proxy, like tree rings. Je ne vois pas les tree rings parce qu'il y a le truc, voilà, tree rings here, pollen, of course. Modelization, speleothems, ice core, paléo sediments. Je vois pas, ça m'énerve. Voilà. And the time of the records are not the same. So many, many proxies are used to reconstruct paleoclimate. For Indonesia, we can separate Indonesia in two big parts. On the left, the green part. On the right, the yellow part. In fact, these two parts are wet. Selalu rainy in the west part and dry, cutting on the east part because the trade winds Alize from the southeast of Indonesia. So now, present day, two general parts. It's clear on this slide, for instance, in the West Java, for the culture, of course, always humid, Selalu
lembab.
Selalu lembab. So, jadi ada teh, ada rice, and on the east part, the field rice are associated with other plants like papaya, like zinkong, like pohon pisang, and also like with taro. Like that. So, jelas lembab to the west side and drier to the east side. Because in fact there is because in fact, on the west part, Selalu Lembab, on the east part, ada musim kemarau, lebih panjang. Kalau saya kurang jelas, silakan stop saya. And okay, rather important climatic factor is the ITCZ. ITCZ is intertropical convergence zone. That means depression, zone of depression. That means rain. So during the austral winter, the ITCZ is to the north of equator. Equator is near Singapore, it's approximately here. So the ITCZ, the depression zone, is on the west of the equator. So at this time, Augustus, for instance, Java is rather dry, and it's musim kemarau. And during the austral summer, for instance, Maret here, the ITCZ is just on the equator, so Java is just on the ITCZ, and it's a rainy season in Java, musim hujan. So now, for the present day, we constat this important climatic factor, the displacement of ITCZ. And we don't know, if 500,000 years ago, it was the same schema. We don't know, but for the, today, it's this schema. Another important factor is, in fact, an anomaly, and the ENSO event. ENSO event is El Niño Southern Oscillation. It's in the Pacific Ocean, Samudra Pacific. I don't know why my screen changed. The important thing is that during the El Niño period, the west side of Pacific and Indonesia is very dry, too dry, drier than normal. I am sorry, but my screen changed scenery. So during El Niño, the west side of the Pacific is abnormally dry, and the east side of the Pacific is abnormally wet. During La Niña, it's the contrary of El Niño, it's the opposite. So really, what is important for Indonesia, for instance, is the El Niño event, because it's very, very dry. We shall see after. and we can observe seasonal variation. On this slide, it's at the top, it's the same place, it's in San Iran, near Nyangebum, on the north of San Iran Dome, during the dry season, Musim Kemaro, and during Musim Ujan. It's exactly the same place, except the Kerbao, the Sapi, pardon. So it's very, very different. And in the bottom of the slide, it's also the same place in Punu, in front of the Santoros Cave, during Kemaro, on the right, and very, very dry. And at this time, people say, inhabitants say that there is no rain since Sembilan Bulan, for instance. So it's really very dry. It's important because there are no rice, nothing. And if I'm not wrong, on the left, in Punum Jugad, in front of the Santoros Cave, it was very, very rainy, too rainy. And it was in 2004, if I remember, in December. So the difference is very, very drastic. For the climate, during the quaternary period is characterized by glacial cycles. It means interglacial plus glacial. During the glacial period, the sea level is decreasing until the formation of land bridges. So because the Java Sea, for instance, is not too deep, during the glacial period, each time there is a glacial period, there is an immersion of this land. And you can see the succession for the quaternary period, 2.6 million years ago until now, many times, cold and warm, and cold and warm. So this alternance of glacial interglacial period are very important for the landscape. Because during the glacial period, the vegetation, the landscape are very open and drier than now. And during glacial interglacial period, the vegetation is like a forested environment and warmer. So during the time, many times we have immersion and island again and immersion. It's important because during glacial period, there is an immersion. So along the river, the conditions are here very, very dry, maybe a savanna, but there is a river. We can observe now under the sea, we can observe fossil river, and along this river can develop the gallery forest. And during this time, during glacial period, there are, for the vegetation and also for the fauna, there are many, many turnover. Jadi binatang, hewan, dan manusia, dan tumbuh-tumbuhan juga, vegetasi, bisa cross this place. A very, very synthetic map of vegetation. Today, we can observe a very important place for the agriculture. So the vegetation is not original vegetation, but again, on the west part of Java, Bela Barat, there is a humid vegetation with rainforest and vegetation, altitudinal vegetation. And on the east part of Java, Bela Timur, Ada vegetasi kering, humid. Then Ada Jugai on painting, reforestation with Pohon Jati and then Pohon Chemara. Duadwanya Chochok, Kalao Kondisi Iklim, Kaling Skali. Okay? Jadi sekarang hutan yang ada, hutan lebih terbuka di sebelah timur, di mana ada banyak cemara, banyak pohon jati, banyak cemara. Dan sebelah barat ada hutan hujan. Tapi yang jelas, banyak-banyak agriculture. Kita, kami kita bisa memrecont... Oh, saya ganti. kita bisa memreconstruksi vegetasi karena pollen. Pollen grain are situated on the stamen of the plant. It's very clear here. Pollen grain on the stamen of the plant, it's a cell, male gamete of the flowering plant. Ferns also, spore of ferns can be associated to the study of pollen grain. The size of the pollen is very, very small, kecil, tigapulu micrometer. What is important for palynology is that for one species, there is one kind of pollen. Satu species, satu pollen. Second important thing is the pollen can fossilize in the sediments. It's better in a clay, for instance, because the pollen is destroyed by oxidation. The third important thing is that the pollen is characterized by the membrane named exine, and the exine is very, very resistant. And on the top of the exine, there are some opening named aperture. Sometimes it's a hole named porus or a furrow named sillon. So there is many, 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 many parameters. And we can observe the biodiversity. Effectively, we can observe ferns of pachys, it's pachys, pachys punia spora, who can pollen, like that or like that, and so many, many different shape of pollen. Lagi, one species, satu species, satu bentuk pollen. Tapi untuk bisa mendeterminasi pollen di bawah mikroskop, we have to elaborate a reference collection from herbarium to be able to determine pollen. If we don't have a reference collection, bagaimana? It's impossible to determine a fossil in the sediment. Many, many important vegetal associations in Indonesia. The first one you see on maybe... Yeah, the first one is the mangrove forest. The mangrove forest is located on the shoreline, in fact. It's very, very interesting forest formation between Cilacap, Tapi sekarang ya rusak sekali. This kind of forest is characteristic because the plants, the trees, can live in the salted water. And in the muddy sediments. So the acar, the roots, are specialized, like this one, pneumatophore, or this one. And it's a palm tree from the mangrove. But we can determine, because it's very, very specific. So this pollen association, if I meet this pollen association in my sediment, I can say, oh, at this time, there was the mangrove forest. I mean, it's important because mangrove means there is country, but means there is water, there is sea or ocean, some water. So it's a very important formation and very rich for the population, very rich. Many fish, many passages. The second one, of course, important, is the coastal vegetation with characteristic pollen grain, like Barringtonia asiatica. I don't know where is it here. Pandanus also is important, like that. And Casuarina equisetifolia. It's in fact Poenjati, but equisetifolia, Poenjati, dipantai. So again, if I meet Calosa ketemu pollen ini idalam sedimen saya, saya bole bilan o watuitu ada shoreline, ada pantai. Another one is for instance, swampy vegetation, rawa, ada, family, yang, khususnya, hidup di dalam rawa. Important forest, monsoon forest or seasonal forest, on the east part of Java, di Java Timur, ada banyak Poenjati. Alors, il y a ça là. Tech, Tectona grandis. Yeah, pollen of Tectona grandis. On the right side, no fire. It's just a very, very dry season. Musim kemara yang keras, jadi pohon, menjadi begitu. For the monsoon forest or seasonal forest, there is also, again, a klompok of pollen, khususnya, from the monsoon forest. The rainforest, very important one, with a very big ferns, and characteristic genus and species from the rainforest. And the last point, in Java, in Indonesia, Kalawada Letusan Gunung Api, species yang pertama datang, pionnière, adalah Poaceae, c'est parti Imperata cylindrica, or, again, Femara, like Casuarina jumonium. Jadi, canal, it's very important to know all this vegetal association, because during the quaternary, we have sometimes changing between rainforest and monsoon forest and very open forest. So we have to know this association. Just a transition, and I talk a little bit about San Mirandome. It's a well-known place for Homo erectus, you know. And when I, for my PhD, for instance, I take many samples in this, along the Chimoro River in other place, and we can reconstruct with our Indonesian colleague, of course, with Tony Jobiantono, with Pat Ruman, and so on, all our friend at this time, and our friend now. We reconstruct a very synthetic stratigraphy of Samiran with Calibang or Puran layers, blue clay, but Lempung Biru, marine Lempung Biru, through this Iniada Transisi, with Gamping and Lahar. Lahar means Letusan Gunung Api, volcanic mud. And just after that, there is a clay, Lempung Itam, non-marine but continental. So these layers are from the lower Pleistocene, and in the black clay we meet diatomite and tuff, many things. It's very synthetic, in fact, but in this layer, the oldest Homo erectus were discovered. And after that, a conglomerate, it's a kind of conglomerate. The Grensbang and Kabu and Bapang, Duanama, Kuchangan Sandiran, Kabu Bapang, Duanama, Untuk, Needle, Pleistocene. So I just present a very synthetic diagram for Sandiran, for the lower Pleistocene. And what is important on the right, you recognize with the color, recognize the association. For instance, here the association of mangrove, here the association of rainforest, association of monsoon forest, swampy forest, and volcanism. For instance, if I try to understand this kind of diagram, I have just to follow the curve of the mangrove association, and I can observe that in the marine sediment, the very important percentage of mangrove pollen. And the regression of mangrove pollen means the regression of the sea at this time. From the marine sediment, we go to the continental sediment. On the relief, because if the mangrove here is important, it means that at this time, 1.8 million years ago, at this time, there is a pantai, there is a shoreline in San Iran, there is a sea. But just before, on the relief, I meet the Swamp Forest Association and also the Rainforest Association and the Monsoon Forest Association in alternance. And this alternance corresponds to the alternance of glacial and glacial glacial period. During interglacial period, more rainforest. During glacial period, it's more monsoon forest. And if you follow this red line, you observe that you have this ciné. You don't have pollen again. Tikida ada pollen lagi di sini. And if I, because I am very surprised, I take pollen sample again, and I observe that just in this place, there are so many pollen from Poaceae and Casuarina, Femara. And if you remember, the signification of these two grain, pollen grain, are volcanism. So, in fact, at this time, there is a big, for the lower Laha here, very big volcanic eruption and the local destruction of the vegetation. So again, the lower layer of the black clay, in this lower layer, we meet the archaic Homo erectus. In San Iran, we don't meet, until now, we don't meet lower the upper Pleistocene. And for the middle Pleistocene, there is many, many problems because the sediment is not clay again. The Grenzbank and the Kabu layer are not clayé, retro. Kalaudisini ada lempung, didalam lempung, lempung ini kayaskali ala polen. Tapi kalau lebih pasiran, kurang banyak polen karena polen tidak suka oksidasi. Jadi kita sama Pak Tony, sama François, kita jalan-jalan di seluruh San Iran Dome, and we get some clayé levels where I can obtain pollen grain. And this pollen grain, there is not here a real diagram. There is only two important indications. The total of AP, AP means arboreal pollen, means tree, kalau AP pohon, and NAP, non-arboreal pollen, means herbs or rumput. Then, untuk level ini, lapisan ini, Grenzbank, di mana ada fosil manusia, fosil Homo erectus, the pollen means banyak rumput, hampir tidak ada pohon, jadi waktu itu, the vegetation was an open vegetation. So we can link, un truc in general, Donc, we can link the vegetation with the glacial period and possible arrival of new Homo erectus and Angelas and arrival of new fauna. So just at this place in the Grenzbank layer. For the Kabu formation, it's almost the same. Huh? I have to get clayey layers because in sandy layer, there is no pollen, tida, ampere tida da pollen, carna oxydacea. Jadi, saya dapat lempung layer. And it was almost the same. Sedikit aja, pohonia, dan banyak rumput. Jadi, di dalam kabu layers, the place we discovered the classical Homo erectus, we discovered, can say, we can say that it was a very open vegetation during a glacial period until maybe savanna sometimes, hein, kadang-kadang, pertida da coron. Jadi, the possibility, a new possibility, because the turnover during glacial period, the possibility to have an arrivals of a new fauna again and maybe new Homo erectus. But in San Iran, there is no upper Pleistocene. So we go now to the southern mountains in the Gunung Sewu and with a very beautiful karstic formation, the Gunung Sewu. And the first time François and me go to this place, it was Truman. And with an Anaxayat, you get Patruman.
Yes. I still remember. Yes, I must ingat,
yeah. Masih kecil, nakal. Ça, c'est pas le sujet. Donc, we go to Santoros, very beautiful cave. And we excavate since the first time we excavate with François and our team and Patruman. It was in 1994, I remember. So it's a rather big excavation. Here it's an extensive excavation and two pits. And the pit Kasatu here with a burial also. And the pit Kasatu, all the friends excavate there, like and this Kasatu pit is rather deep, 15 meters, and it's very interesting because at the basis we have this dating, and at the top is approximately 6,000 years ago. So all this stratigraphy means that we meet the transition from Homo erectus to Homo sapiens in this place. For the study of vegetation, it's a little difficult because the sediments are oxidized, but with the help of the fauna, we can consider that in the stratigraphy, there is three main layers, the torus layers, Tabuan layers with the dating, yeah, and Keplek layers. And with the fauna and the pollen grain, we can observe that at this time there is a rainforest. It's for me because the pollen is very, almost no pollen, but for the fauna it's okay. So rainforest, pollen with fauna, it means that it's during that time at the top of the Pleistocene, we observe the open environment, and during the Holocene, rainforest again. So maybe in these three layers, three different populations, because the tools are, the lithic is not the same, the fauna is not the same, and on this burial, I get It's rather strange. I get many, many spora of pakis, different spora of pakis. So I want to finish there, but I have to say that, of course, palynologists have to work with, of course, anthropologists, sedimentologists, and zoologists. And during the time, it was just synthesized by Njiko, that many biozone, and because the glacial period, each time there is glacial period, there is a new turnover and more rich faunistic association. This work is a synthesis, of course, and the faunal results are in according with the vegetal palynological research. Many studies from von Königswald, De Vos, and Sandar, until the very new data from the thesis of Masami and for Saniran. And again, you can observe that during the time, more and more diversity of fauna. Voilà, I just finished by this observation. For the climate, many studies, many modelization, and we observe that just forcing with the sun and natural factors, and forcing with natural and anthropic factors. Very big difference. So, voilà. Yes, this example of problem for the environment. Because of the climate, for instance, it was during a very, very drastic El Nino, the Borneo forest begin to get fire. It was pity. And also, I have the opportunity to work in Easter Island, and the vegetation almost disappeared because human, of course, but also because a very, very repetitive ENSO events. And for my conclusion, we have just to take care because too dry, too wet, it's a big problem, and we have just to try to manage. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih.
Baik, terima kasih Ibu Anmari atas presentasinya. Paparannya cukup sangat menarik ya, Bapak Ibu sekalian. Kawan-kawan CPAS, kolega CPAS yang mengikuti talk show pada siang hari ini. Saya mengundang kepada Bapak-Ibu sekalian, akan mengundang kepada Bapak-Ibu sekalian yang ada pada siang hari ini untuk bertanya langsung kepada Ibu Anmari. Silakan Anda dapat menggunakan fitur raise hand atau mengetikkan di kolom komentar. Untuk bertanya langsung kepada Ibu Anmari. Saya ada satu pertanyaan khusus untuk Ibu Anmari. Kita melihat adanya kemunculan savana ya, ketika tadi sudah dijelaskan, we see ya, in your presentation that there was a savana in Indonesia. But how come it can be possible to have a savana in what we see today as a wet environment and very humid environment, please?
In fact, the term savanna for the vegetation, only for the vegetation, not for the animals, for the fauna. Okay. In my mind, savanna means almost no trees.
So it must be like
for instance in the east part of Java, no?
Yes. Like in Sumba. Savanna.
But I say savanna with a point d'interrogation, but it's not like in Africa, just a vegetal botanical term. Almost no tree.
Almost no tree, so it will be just grass and like, yes, maybe more like open woodland, very dry, yes, but very less vegetation.
When you describe the vegetation, you have the forest. In Java and in Indonesia, for instance, there are two kinds of forests: the rainforest with special pollen, special tree for the rainforest, and another kind of forest, the monsoon forest, with other species of trees. The monsoon forest is not a poor rainforest, it's another forest. So during the lower Pleistocene, there is sometimes rainforest, sometimes monsoon forest, but always forest. But during for instance, the middle Pleistocene, on all my studies, there is sometimes very low percentage of trees, and it's not a forest because the percentage of trees is too low, but sometimes I just say open environment. But if there is almost no trees, I say it's maybe a kind of savanna, but it's just a term of botanic.
Okay, thank you very much for the explanation. I always interesting with the existence of savanna in point of interrogation, because we all from the fauna record we also know the existence of hyena, for example, the crocuta. It does exist in Javanese Pleistocene fossil record, right? And maybe I just imagine before, I was imagined like more or less it's just like in Africa, but it is clear that you stated maybe before that it's not really quite like in Africa. It's quite different because it also connected with the climate maybe during the ice age in Indonesia. We have one question. Yes, please continue.
Okay, okay. May I have some comments about savanna? That's as we know that savanna or savanna is very special in Sumba Island. You can find savanna everywhere in Sumba, but not in the other islands of Lesser Sunda. Now, this is a big question for me. Yeah. What happened to this island? Why in this island we find so very many savanna and not in the other islands? Yeah, maybe Ibu and Mari can explain a little bit about this, but see, because it's so strange. Yeah.
Yes.
Flores is not so far from Sumba, and the same for Timor and also Sabu, but only in this island. The most part of the islands is savanna or savanna. Thank you, Bon Marie.
Merci. I really don't know. I tried to study the phytoliths in Sumba, but I have so many problems. Okay. I'm sorry. Because I don't talk about phytoliths, but there is not only pollen for the reconstruction of the vegetation and landscape. I don't know why. What is clear, it's the southeast part of Indonesia is drier than the west part, but for the savanna, maybe it's just a problem of sediment, a problem of irrigation, a problem because the vegetation is also linked with the nature of sediment. So if you don't have the same sediment, sometimes sediment is very poor, and the forest cannot develop. I don't know. Yeah. It's possible that it's because the sediment, the soil. in my opinion.
Yeah, so you have to go there, Buan Maria.
Yes.
To see the salon. It's very interesting and very, very beautiful.
I agree.
Yeah. Okay.
You agree?
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Prof, atas pertanyaannya. Thank you very much, Buan Maria. We have one question from Mbak Marlin. Mbak Marlin, are you still with us?
Hello.
Please, Mbak Marlin. Hello, Mbak Marlin. Okay. Silakan, Mbak Marlin.
Okay, yeah, I will try my very best English, Mas Ruli.
Oh.
So, okay. So please you can not understand. Tidak apa-apa. Hello, hello, Prof. Mari. Nama saya Marlin. Saya yeah. dari Papua.
Yeah.
So I was very interesting about your presentation today, and then you mentioned about El Nino. That was it was of the one of the climate pattern, and that's also largely happen or occur in Papua in Southeast Asia and especially in Indonesia, and also occur in Papua in the past. So this one of my questions: how to differentiate between the pollen that resulted or from human or cultural activity and from with the pollen from or grain, pollen grains from El Nino phenomena, for example, like this. So it is quite difficult to find out how to deal with this.
I am not sure that I understand the question.
Is this about the pollen from El Nino and
El Nino?
El Nino. El Nino.
Yes, maybe the question is about how to reconstruct or how to point out point out the indication of El Nino event during the past from the pollen grain.
Okay. Not about it. It's actually about how to differentiate. Bagaimana membedakan pollen yang dihasilkan dari apa ini dari yang merupakan hasil dari cultural activity atau human-made or something like this, and pollen yang terjadi sendirinya, bukan pollen terjadi sendirinya, akibat dari contohnya, because El Nino is always something like this warm pulse, that means that can be happen by itself, and so for example, when this happen, this will be something like a burn, for example, the tree or the grass, for example, like this. So, so hopefully you can understand. I mean, how do you differentiate this one?
I think I understand, but I look for, because I prepare other slide, and but I don't know if I have the good one.
Okay.
Non, c'est pas ça. Ça fait rien. In general, like I said. If you want to understand the past, you have to know the present. So when I begin my PhD, I begin to construct to learn what are the main vegetal associations in Indonesia. For instance, like I said, mangrove forest and so on and so on. And humid vegetation, dry vegetation, because it's a very important factor. And I make a reference collection. And if I meet in my sediment, I meet pollen from trees from dry association, I can say at this time it was dry association. But if I, Elotida sala, Adajuga, Tentang, culture, Missalnia, Calof family Poaceae. Poaceae, painting scaly, hein? Poaceae mean like that, hein? Just herb. But in this family, there is maïs, ragoon, there is bamboo, there is many important rice. Many important species, wild or for the agriculture. Dan biasanya misalnya kalau mais, it's very difficult to or rice, hein, dua-duanya poase, dua-duanya herbs, the same family, rice and mais, the same family. It's very difficult to determine from the pollen because all the poaceae are like that, bulat, with satu porus. Satu porus, adja. C'est-à-dire, there is no character like colpus, porus. Almost all the poaceae are like that. So it's very difficult. But in general, for instance, if poaceae is from the agriculture, like rice, like jagum, the pollen is bigger. Karna, because with the agriculture, there is, comment dire, culture and culture, the population take care of the plant, and the plant is bigger and bigger, and the pollen also. So cultivated plants have pollen, bigger pollen for the size. And in student of me work near the Santorosque, for instance, and in a three little lake, and diadapat didalam stratigraphy langsung in the tiga tempat. Approximately at the same time, ada satu pollen dari poaceae yang pertama kali dapat, a big one. So she works very hardly with the MEB, microscope electronic à balayage, and she determine jagum. Tapi dia perlu tiga bulan mungkin untuk bisa determine pollen jagung. Jadi saya kurang tahu apakah saya jelas atau tidak, tapi waktu ada cultivation, ada culture, the pollen grain is bigger than the wild species. So from the size of the pollen, we can say, oh, this, for instance, this herb, this poaceae is cultivated because it's jealous bigger than, and we said at this moment we said cereals.
Baik, okay. Terima kasih. Bagaimana Mbak Marlin, apakah sudah jelas?
Ya, seperti itu. Karena okay. Kalau ada pertanyaan Mas nanti saya. Ya,
oh. Nanti kalau kurang jelas.
Kalau kurang jelas nggak apa-apa.
Okay. Kita wajar.
It's actually, I think this is clear already. So.
Okay, terima kasih Mbak Marlin.
Yeah. Okay.
Salam untuk keluarga di Papua.
Okay, bye. Okay.
Sampai bertemu lagi. Okay, jadi ada dua pertanyaan menarik. Ada dua pertanyaan menarik dari yang pertama dari Pak Lutfi Yondri, saya bacakan ya Ibu Ann Mari ya, dalam bahasa Indonesia. Selamat siang Ibu Ann Mari, izin bertanya bagaimana keadaan iklim pada masing-masing masa perkembangan fauna di Nusantara pada masa lalu. Apakah sering berubah keadaan iklim pada masa lalu? Dan apakah perubahan iklim itu berpengaruh terhadap perkembangan komposisi fauna mungkin di sini ya, perkembangan fauna atau punahnya fauna-fauna tertentu. Mungkin
je suis pas sûr de tu peux me résumer?
We know that during the past the like what you have presented before there was a abrupt climatic change. It's really often it's really marked on the every box proxies, every climate proxies appears, you know, from the archaeological site, for instance. And then the question is, how often the climate changed during the past, and is this kind of a climate change give impact to the faunal composition or because it caused some kind of a faunal extinction or the disappearance of several species of faunal, Pleistocene fauna in Indonesia, for instance.
Yes, in fact, for the during the Quaternary period, there is an alternance of glacial and interglacial period with a frequency of 41,000 years and 100,000 years. So the cyclicity is regular. And sometimes when the glacial is very, very important, the, you see my screen?
Yes, we see your screen.
So there is a cyclicity, and sometimes, and only sometimes, when there is a very important glaciation, there is a formation of languages and turnover. So you have to consider, for instance, that the animals, A1, who cross the land bridges, cross, of course, the land bridges during glacial period. But they are not obviously adapted to dry condition, to open environment. So it's why I said that it's possible for some animals like primates, like monyet, it's difficult for them to cross a non-rainforest environment. So probably they follow the river and they follow the forest in the gallery forest. So what is clear is that during the Quaternary period, we observe, of course, because the turnover and the land bridges, except for the animals, the swimming animal. Each time there is a glacial period. Ah, pity. Sorry. Huh? Each time there is a glacial period, there is new arrival of fauna, but also because it's not like on the road, the animals, because the land bridges can come from the daratan, but also some animals can come back. Huh? In the two directions, it's possible.
Yes.
There is not only a way. So there is a very big space, emerge space, and animals, new animals can come with Homo erectus, with Homo sapiens, can come, and other one can kembali ke continent, ke daratan. Alors, qu'est-ce que c'était la question? So it's not each glaciation, because sometimes the glaciation is not so important. But during the very big glaciation, like this one, for instance, 2022, or this one, it's possible really to have big land bridges and turnover, but not each glaciation. So during the Quaternary, yes, during the more important glaciation, the glaciation was important enough to for the formation of land bridges and possible turnover.
Okay, thank you very much. Maybe there was a main event, right? There was a main event between each glaciation, each event, each smaller event, mm-hmm. there will be the biggest event or the main event in of glaciation, yes. and interglacial period. Like, for example, we know that in Song Trus, Marine Isotopic Stage E, 5E, right. Really important, and it's connected to the development of rainforest in Java, ya Bu Anmaria.
Yes, but for the vegetation, it's more difficult because the plant cannot cannot go.
Yes,
in the place. that there is a kind of maybe lava to vegetation. Tapi misalnya misalnya di antara Java Barat dan Java Timur sekarang vegetasi vegetasi betul hein, forest tidak sama tapi dari temperatur dari dari hujan gak begitu jauh tapi cukup untuk ada hutan yang tidak sama. For the animals is different. They can there's three possibilities. Kalau lingkungan diganti, tapi diganti praktikal, ada tiga possibilities. Adaptasi, migrasi, atau meninggal. Kalau adaptasi bisa. Kalau tidak bisa dan bisa ganti tempat, ada migrasi. Tidak suka misalnya lingkungan, dia bisa pergi cari yang lain. Jadi ada adaptasi, ada migrasi. Dan kalau tidak bisa mengadaptasi, tidak bisa migrasi, meninggal.
Ya, atau punah ya. Cuma tiga kemungkinan ya, Ibu Anmar ya.
Menurut saya, kalau ada satu lagi ya boleh ya.
Baik, terima kasih. Ada pertanyaan satu lagi dari Pak Sony Wibisono yang mau pertanyaannya dibacakan saja karena gangguan sinyal. Selamat pagi, Ibu Anmar. Pertanyaannya ialah, saya tertarik, Pak Sony tertarik dengan stratigrafi Songtrus. Seperti perubahan dari rainforest ke lingkungan terbuka, lalu kembali lagi ke rainforest lagi. Pertanyaannya, apa penyebab perubahan tersebut? What caused that kind of change? And faktor apa yang menyebabkan perubahan itu? Terima kasih dan salam buat Prof. François Sema. Silakan Ibu Anna.
Ya, jadi di Songtrus ada stratigrafi yang cukup panjang, tapi yang paling bawah, terus layer, bukan archaeological soil yang betul. Waktu itu ada sungai yang cross the cave, named Songtrus, hein, kalau Songtrus, jelas terus. Jadi sedimen ini bukan archaeological layers betul. Tetapi di dalamnya ada alat batu yang seperti ini hein, dari terus yang cukup bagus, cukup mirip pacitanian. Ya lebih kecil tapi warna dan kualitasnya hampir sama. Kemungkinan besar tapi pari hein, bilang gajah kalau saya salah atau terlalu salah ya itu datang ini kemungkinan besar Homo erectus yang buat ini tapi di dalam stratigrafi ini saya sama waktu itu saya masjid dari Bandung saya turun sampai bawah hein, 15 meter dan kita ambil contoh beberapa contoh. C'est la ma stratigraphie. Tapi jelas di bawah, saya tidak dapat banyak karena di tempat ini air sungai di bawah ada sungai yang lewat di bawah goa sekarang ada sungai yang lewat. Jadi air naik turun untuk polen jelek sekali. Polen tidak jadi jelas merusak, dirusak karena air naik turun. Jadi saya dapat sedikit saja, kualitatif. Kalau data, hein, saya harus bilang kualitatif. Oops. Je mets en comment, voilà. Ini ada yang bilang. Bon, dari sini data lebih dari fauna daripada polen. Saya dapat sedikit saja. Jadi saya tidak berani, ini karena saya tidak berani bilang dari polen rainforest. Tapi dari dari Fona ini asosiasi jelas yang tinggal di hutan hujan. Yang penting saya kira di atas lapisan tabuan, c'est-à-dire jadi di Upper Pleistocene, sekitar 12.000 tahun yang lalu, polen yang saya dapat, Mimosaceae, Asteraceae, ada juga Barringtonia, Barringtonia yang dari pantai, yang lucu. Tapi jelas-jelas di sini hanya polen dari vegetasi yang terbuka. Dan di dalam stratigrafi di sini, dans jadi waktu itu open environment, hein, vegetasi terbuka, dan juga dari sedimen, dari sedimentologi, hein, karena tadi saya bilang selalu kerja sama orang sedimentologi, dari sedimen juga sedikit pasiran, dan di sini, dan juga kalau tidak salah, tidak ada banyak tulang, tidak ada banyak alat batu, tapi waktu di sini, yang pas di atas hijau, ada lapisan kecil, carbonated, dari dumping. Jadi, activity dari karst, kembali lagi. Jadi, sebelumnya kondisinya kering, dan karst, kerja lagi. Hujan, tambah hujan waktu itu. Dan di dalam sedimen yang lebih lempungan di sini, donc, jadi lebih bagus untuk polen, untuk dapat polen, ada polen dari hutan hujan. Dan kalau fauna di sini juga ada bovid, ada cervid, kalau tidak salah, di sini di lapisan keplek ada polen dari hutan hujan dan baru ada banyak monyet yang tinggal di hutan hujan. Jadi, kalau hasil dari palinologi ikut hasil dari fauna. Di sini juga. Et di sini ya, kurang banyak polen. Jadi, bagaimana?
Tapi ada satu pertanyaan, apa yang menyebabkan lingkungan masa lalu berubah, Wan Mari? Itu pada intinya, what is the major factor behind the climatic change during the past?
Yang jelas di Indonesia tidak ada banyak perubahan. Kalau dingin, kecuali mungkin di Bromo, tidak perlu pakai pullover. Zaman es di Java mungkin 7 sampai 8 derajat kurang. Gak begitu banyak.
Dan, bukan dingin tapi sejuk ya mungkin.
Saya tidak bisa bilang dingin, mungkin yeah, lebih dingin, sedikit lebih dingin atau sedikit lebih panas. Kalau kondisinya kering, tidak sampai Sahara, jelas. Tetapi dari orang botanik, mereka, kalau observasi sekarang, mereka kasih tahu bahwa 5 sampai 8 derajat kurang atau lebih, dan hujannya ada juga persentase, tidak perlu banyak bedanya, tapi cukup untuk pohon, misalnya pohon dari hutan hujan, kalau sedikit lebih kering, kalau sedikit kurang hujan, mereka tidak mau hidup lagi. Diganti oleh yang lebih cocok.
Padahal cuma sedikit saja ya perubahannya ya Bu Anmari.
Sedikit dan secara pelan-pelan juga.
Secara pelan-pelan.
Ya, tapi yang lucu misalnya di antara yang misalnya lihat di Sangiran misalnya pas di antara barat dan timur dan posisinya kalau kondisi diganti kondisi iklim diganti pas di batas c'est pas diganti. D'accord, on t'a pas capté là ça tout. Alors barat atau timur mungkin lebih lama. Mais ça c'est juste des hypothèses. Mais kondisi untuk hutan hujan dan untuk misalnya hutan lebih kering, kondisinya tidak sama, tapi dans la Lujao, dari pluviosity, dari température, ga begitu jauh. Tapi cukup untuk pohon dari hutan hujan, tidak cocok lagi, kalau température turun, atau kalau hujan turun sedikit. Saya tidak tahu berapa, hein? Tapi tidak cocok lagi, diganti oleh spesies baru yang lebih suka kondisi ini secara pelan-pelan. Et mungkin kalau menjadi kering di Java Barat secara pelan-pelan, belum tentu anak saya atau cucu saya, tapi kalau menjadi lebih kering di Java Barat, bentar lagi di Java Barat, tidak ada hutan hujan lagi. Tapi perlu lama, cukup lama.
Baik, terima kasih Ibu Mari. Jadi tadi mungkin intinya juga kita tidak bisa merekonstruksi atau menentukan kondisi vegetasi tanpa didukung oleh faunanya misalnya, atau tanpa didukung oleh data lainnya. Jadi asosiasi itu penting. Ya,
hubungan. Ini yang penting. Ini yang penting. Seorang palinolog, menurut saya, tidak kerja sendiri. Saya selalu kerja sama sedimentolog. Saya selalu kerja sama datation, dating. Karena kalau saya kerja keras tanpa tahu waktu saya kerja, tidak ada gunanya. Jadi, saya selalu kerja sama sedimentologi. Karena kalau saya dapat sedimen pasiran, hampir saya tidak usah saya mulai kerja. Tidak ada polen, terlalu rusak. Jadi saya selalu kerja sama orang sedimentologi, sama fauna juga. Saya masih ingat sama Pak Devos, waktu dia kerja tentang binatang, tentang hewan, saya kerja tentang polen. We compare our results. It was the same. Tidak dikasih dulu, tapi oh, saya dapat hutan hujan, dia dapat binatang dari hutan hujan. Cocok. Harus.
Okay. Baik, terima kasih. Mungkin sudah menjawab ya Pak Sony ya, bagaimana faktor apa yang menyebabkan perubahan masa lalu dan kemudian bagaimana bisa berubah dari masa ke masa berdasarkan apa yang terkenang di situs Song terus. Mudah-mudahan bisa menjawab apa yang disampaikan oleh Ibu Anmari tadi. Kemudian ada satu lagi pertanyaan Ibu Anmari dari Bu Triwuryani. Ibu Anne, mohon penjelasan, menurut Ibu apakah analisis stable isotop, nah ini menarik nih Ibu Anmari, apakah stable isotop sudah cukup mewakili untuk mengetahui lingkungan masa lalu di samping analisis polen? Apakah juga bisa menggambarkan iklim dari stable isotop tersebut, Ibu Anmari? Terima kasih. Salam.
Ya. Saya bukan spesialis tentang isotop, tapi isotop kebetulan penting sekali karena ice core ada referensi yang ikut isotop yang kasih model untuk kurva ini. Wilson, les corvins, une corva et demie. Voilà. Et né d'Ari Isotope, corva et demie. Qui t'adapte corva et demie, température d'Ari Isotope. Diambil dit d'Alam corps. Corps dit. Di article ni ada beberapa referensi yang même reconstruksi dari isotop. Kova ini dari isotop aja.
Tapi hanya untuk perwakilan. It's only for proxy for the paleo temperatures or for the precipitation. How this temperature could change or to how this temperature could affect the vegetation, we should study palynology, ya Bu Anne Maria. Okay, so what I mean is what is the main question is is it only is stable isotope can only stand alone with stable isotope only, we could reconstruct the paleoclimate. So,
the study of isotope just gives the temperature of the water of the sea, for instance.
Yes, that's what I said.
So, I think it's just the first step. And for instance, if I don't have this isotopic stage, if I don't have, I just have stratigraphy. It's impossible, but I have a stratigraphy to study with palynology, and it's sampled from 2.6 million years ago until now. I have Ribuan Chanto, and in some samples, Idalam Chanto Sayadapat Rainforest, Idalam Chanto Sayadapat Open Forest, Bolé. Tampatao Corvini, it don't exist, but if an hypothesis, there is a stratigraphy of 2.6 million years ago, stratigraphy, and a team, big team of palynologists and archaeozoologists work in the samples during two or three lives. They get sometimes, of course, they get rainforest, open forest. But it's impossible. It's impossible. So the study of isotope with the study of carbonate and the temperature of the sea surface temperature, something like that, it's more, it's possible to construct this curve with isotope. With another tool, I don't think that it will be possible. Okay, it's a more easy. It's a more easy topic proxy to reconstruct the warm and cold curve.
Yes, but still, if we want to reconstruct the landscape, for instance, for to reconstruct the paleo vegetation, we should see the pollen directly. Juan Marie.
Yes. Alors, for the reconstruction of the vegetation, like I said. Je cherche, hein, voilà. Sometimes there is no pollen. So there is other vegetal proxy for paleo vegetation. For instance, anthracology, because for each species, also each genus, the wood, the structure of the wood is not the same. So with charcoal, with charcoal, we can. There is a reference collection also And sometimes in some sediments, if we get a rather big arang, arang yang besar, the cell of the arang are characteristic of the genus. So anthracology, it's important. For instance, Magali Chakornak in Guyang-Warang near Santoros get a curve of charcoal. If there is many charcoal, maybe there is a human impact, something like that. So charcoal is important. There is also carpology, the seed, DG, and it's possible to determine BG, Didalam, Sidman, Kadangadangada. It's important also, Pentium Juga, then phytolite, Bukan cell, but inside the cell. So, Dari Bentuk, phytolite, it's possible to say that Bisabilang, Apaka, Kalao Bentukini, phytolite, dalam silica, kraskali, phytolite, kadankanan, kalao Bentukini, misania, condicinia, warm and wet. Panas dan lembab. Kalao Bentukini, kebetulan, ou Bentukini, yang penting sekali, Bentukini, misalnya, daripadi. Penting sekali, karena kalau mau mendeterminasi pollen rice, pollen tidak bisa. Ou c'est biasa, tidak bisa. Kalau lewat phytolite, bisa. Jadi, ada pollen, ada anthracologie, ada carpologie, ada phytolite. Et voilà. Dan kadang-kadang kalau sedimen teroksidasi tidak ada pollen lagi, ada phytolite, karena untuk phytolite tidak apa-apa oksidasi.
Baik, jadi bukan cuma pollen ya, Ibu Anmari. It's not only pollen, but also other plant remains, plant residue.
Yes, apa saja baik. Yang bisa bantu, boleh.
Ya, yeah, baik. Termasuk microcharcoal. Microcharcoal yang terkandung. Ya, termasuk sedimen.
Dari sedimen aja bisa bilang apakah waktu itu kering atau tidak. Dari sedimen aja. Mais en painting, pluridisciplinarité.
Iya, yang penting banyak studi lainnya.
Kerjasama.
Kerjasama yang penting kalau di ilmu tentang paleontologi. Baiklah, Bapak Ibu sekalian, ada pertanyaan? Jika ingin bertanya, silakan saya mengundang Bapak Ibu sekalian untuk langsung bertanya kepada Ibu Anmari Semah mengenai vegetasi masa lalu, mengenai perubahan iklim. Tapi sambil sebelum masuk ke Bapak Ibu sekalian mungkin masih memikirkan pertanyaannya, I have one interesting question. Is we know that there is a cycle of climate change during the past, and now we are facing climate change. What is the difference between current or modern climate change and the climate change during the past? Ibu Anmari, silakan.
Alors, the principle of I look for my voilà. The principle of glaciation during the Quaternaire, the first time was elaborated by Milankovitch, and Milankovitch considers that for glaciation. The glaciation can be defined by when the high latitude of the north hemisphere get a minimal solar radiation during summer. It's a definition of glaciation for Milankovitch. And he considers that there is three parameters, important parameters for the position of the Earth: eccentricity, obliquity, and precession, the equinox precession. It means that. So during the time, each parameter, eccentricity, obliquity, equinox precession, have a period, the period. different periods. And the position of the Earth with the, north, the real north and the north following the orbit, sorry, I make many, no, change during the time because of the periodicity of this parameter. It's just a problem of insulation, in fact. And if I add all these parameters, you see that because the cyclicity during along the time, the same situation is, I don't know. But the result is the important thing in the insulation on the north during summer, the importance of insulation, and the fourth, the quatrième, no, un, deux, trois, the cinquième, this one is because all these parameters and their cyclicity, the result of the glaciation, glacial, interglacial, interglacial, glacial, interglacial, glacial, is the result of this parameter. And these parameters are deduced from the position of the Earth on the axis and on the solar orbital. I don't know, but it's really very fixed. Huh? It's because the obliquity of the, and the cyclicity of obliquity of the Earth on the orbit solar orbital, the precession of equinox, study all this position, the precession of equinox, the eccentricity. The result is the insulation of the Earth, and the result of all these parameters are the cycle of glaciation. So if there is no human of and if there is no Homo sapiens, only Homo erectus, this schema can be continued. But because there is no Homo sapiens, je ne sais plus où est ma figure, là c'était à la fin de la modélisation, sorry. Because there is no Homo sapiens, this normal cyclus, cycle, pardon, there is an acceleration. I don't know if I answered to your question, but it's just like that. If there is no human intervention, the alternance glacial interglacial go on and go on and go on.
Okay. So in this image, really clear, yeah, Bu Ann Maria, it's really clear that it is a model for the natural changing, the natural yes. climate change mm-hmm. and versus the model of human now current voilà. actual climate mm-hmm. change. So it's really clear that we have a huge impact to our yes. environment.
Because we don't take care. We really think sometime plastic, for instance, is a big progress. It, at this time when I read Anna Ketchil, plastic is wonderful. It's very practiced and so on and so on. But now in the sea and oceans. There's a continent of plastic. So it's the accumulation of progress. And we have just to take care. And if I really understood the GIEC conclusion, we have to take care, but very quickly now.
Yes, now first. And or like you said, we have to adapt. We have to adapt to the environment, adapt by our culture itself, by stop using or reduce using plastic or reduce the pollution, yes. etc.
This side is a little bit pessimist, but it's a reality. And before there is there's many migration, I work also, Patroman said, know that I work also in the Pacific and about the settlement of the Pacific. There are many volunteer migration, but no, people are in the very low island in the Pacific, people have to migrate.
And also low populated, yeah, Buan Maria.
Yes.
These are also low populated, low pollution, but the biggest impact is for them.
Yes.
Pollution came from the city, larger country.
Unfortunately, very often it's the poor people we have to.
Yes.
The first one to have a big problem is the poor people. But yes. I don't talk about réchauffement climatique. I talk about dérèglement climatique. I don't know dérèglement. It's not only warmer. It's désorganisé. I don't know the word. You know.
Oh, maybe ketidakteraturan dari apa namanya yang perubahan atau kondisi iklim yang tidak teratur, yang tidak bisa diprediksi, fenomena-fenomena alam yang di luar dari model normal, di luar naturalnya. Mungkin ada pertanyaan yang lain dari rekan-rekan kawan CPAS di sini. Jika tidak ada, mungkin bisa kita akhiri diskusi pada siang hari ini. Mungkin sedikit saja Ibu An Mari sudah berpesan ya tadi ya, dari slide Ibu An Mari jelas bahwa iklim berubah sejak, dan itu natural sejak masa lalu sehingga sekarang, tapi yang berbahayanya ialah ada perubahan iklim yang tidak teratur dalam tanda kutip tadi, di luar dari model normal yang seharusnya terjadi. Mungkin if you have any message to people here, to people join this meeting today, about the climate, about how we deal with our environment, please Bu An Mari, as a closing statement from you.
I can say I have just to pray, but it's not enough, maybe. No, the problem is an economical problem, because it's not only because the people is bad, but it's for economic importance. Some country choose they don't choose to destroy the planet, but they don't take care because economy is more important. So I just hope that solidarity between country, between culture also, the solidarity and the possibility to work together, because it's possible. We have to take care to save our planet.
And keep studying our environment to learn from the past.
Because when in the IRD, I work for paleoclimatology to get data to give to the modelizer. So I work in archaeology with François and Patrouman and Pauidianto in Java, but besides this work, archaeology, I work in paleoclimatology, and the paleoclimatologue work to give data from the past to the modelizer. Then the modelizer works with this old data to have anticipation for the future.
Okay, thank you very much, Bu An Mari. Menarik sekali closing statement-nya. Mungkin Kak, saya mengundang dari Prof. Truman Simanjuntak, jika ada closing statement, silakan Prof. Masih di mute Prof, sorry Prof.
Oke,
silakan Prof.
So we have just discussed the dynamic of paleoclimate in Indonesia, particularly in Java. Menarik sekali. Banyak pertanyaan ya, dan banyak yang jawabannya membutuhkan penjelasan yang panjang lebar. Ya. Ya. Jadi ini salah satu tanda jika paleoclimate itu topik yang sangat-sangat menarik. Ya. Tapi saya kok tidak mendengar muridnya Bu Anmari ya bicara, ada Mbak Anjar entah lagi sibuk dengan administrasi atau bagaimana. Oke. Okay. Okay, so thank you very much Bu Anmari for sharing such interesting issue, ya. Yeah. And also of course many thanks to the participants for your presence and for your questions and comments too. Yeah. And you know that the paleoclimate studies are always very interesting and very important. Yeah. Because not only about the past, but also about the present. Yeah. This is the reason. Yeah. And we know too that the climate gives influence to the environment. Yeah. The environment gives influence to the vegetation. Yeah. And also to the fauna life and even for human life. This is the point, in my view, why the paleoclimate, yeah, is very, very interesting studies. Yeah. But as we know, in fact, there are still very few researchers who are interested on this field of study. So yeah, by this discussion, I hope there will be more, and more students to become interested in this study for the future. Yeah. So Bu Anmari, si c'est possible, envoyez s'il te plaît de PowerPoint. C'est important pour la documentation de CPAS. Ok, donc.
Dengan senang hati, Pak.
Terima kasih. Sangat penting untuk dokumentasi CPAS. Okay, I think that's all. So it's time to close the discussion by expressing again our gratitude to the narasumber, to Bu Anmari, and of course to all participants. So see you again in the next OPT. Selalu lupa. Yeah. Online, public, di mana tuh? Catatan saya. Sampai ketemu lagi di OPT yang berikutnya with the same or another issue of course. Ya, kita akan memprogramkan ini tiap bulan ya dengan menghadirkan para super pakar. Ya, so again, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ibu Anmari. Merci beaucoup, Pak Truman. Merci beaucoup terima kasih kepada para hadirin yang sudah setia untuk bergabung bersama kita semua, kepada ya peserta yang di Zoom, baik yang tadi dari awal ataupun yang sudah keluar duluan, dan juga peserta dari YouTube. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Sampai jumpa di acara Talkshow CPAS selanjutnya. Salam.
Terima kasih Bu Anmari untuk semuanya. Terima kasih.